The game is about to get its second to last week of Operation Challenges, so if you're interested in completing them all, get on with it. But as well as this, the game has seen a bigger update, 600 megabytes large. Check out the crosshair options menu, which will let you customize your crosshair to your heart's content. And you can even share them with others using this handy little code, which will save players the hassle of all those console commands you used to have to do. Despite players swearing by them for years, I'm not sure if there are types of crosshair that will considerably improve your ability, but there are definitely some that will make you worse, which this new tool will hopefully help you to avoid by letting you test your crosshair's visibility across the most popular maps, like Office and Aztec. Though I personally think these images could do with a bit of AI upscaling. But what would I know? The new custom player models can be further customized with patches, which are kind of like stickers, only instead of applying them to weapon skins, you smear it on any custom player models you own, placed in one of three pre-chosen locations. Openable packs of these patches can be bought, and they come in various quality grades, though all seem to have the same fabric finish, so no pearlescent shiny ones just yet. As well as making your character look more unique, this might also double up as a next-gen strat by Valve to improve player model visibility. Let's consider the possibilities. Top tier teams could get their own logo patches, you can literally see who they are from the players' models in gameplay clips in tournaments. Also, customizable patches is one step closer to my dream of being able to customize my player's face, which I prophesied about 12 years ago and still cling to. The buy menu has had an overhaul. Upon opening it, your crosshair is transported to the middle of it, which means that with a quick flick and click in any direction, you can jump closer to buying your desired equipment. Though this does mean thousands of hours of muscle memory wasted, which I suspect will be the witty top comment in the comment section by the time you watch this video. And I'm still a fan of using the number buttons myself. You'll even be able to see what you can and cannot buy before needing to click a thing, since there are now little icons for each item, with those you are unable to afford being blacked out. You'll see your customized character model awkwardly holding whichever weapon you have selected, so you can now see how awesome you'd look when running about in-game. I suspect this was added to give increased value to the game's custom skins and models. The default maximum frame rate has been upped from 300 to 400. This is dictated by the console command fps_max. You might be asking yourself if it's worth changing from the default value, and the answer is no, unless you're going to run a benchmark where your frame rate might jump above it, in which case replace it with 0 to remove the frame rate cap. I don't think the vast majority of players are going to notice the increase from 300 to 400. But with faster PCs and higher refresh rate monitors coming to market, it's a token gesture from the game to stay ahead of things. Though I'd have preferred a number like 480, which is divisible by all sorts, a bit like 240. Upon firing the AWP while crouch moving, your movement speed used to immediately jump to the maximum of 68 units a second, but now it climbs gradually, restricting player acceleration to how it should be. I highly doubt there are any major exploits that could be done from this bug, but it was a bug, so it has been patched. Again, Valve staying on top of things. As well as this, Breach and Studio have had small changes, which I've enjoyed hunting for. Breaches are mostly clipping. The window in mid has been clipped to stop weapons and bombs from being chucked through it. That bit at the bottom of the stairs in middle has been clipped. The wall with the door at the back of middle has been clipped. At long A, you could rest the bomb and guns on the top of this sign, but the clipping now extends all the way up into space. Guns could poke through this wall in the office near A, but not anymore. The ambient occlusion has gone from the world. I think maybe different compile settings were used. And last, my favourite. One of the clips for Wingman didn't work before, so you can run through it to T-spawn and to the rest of the map, escaping from the match. And for Studio, something very strange has happened. A lot of these patch notes seem to refer to updates that were already featured in the game, so I'll be comparing three versions of the map here. A few adjustments to props and bomb decals were added to Bombsite A. You can see that a few clip brushes have also shifted about. Then, in the latest update, the poly count of the curved wall was reduced for some reason. In Bombsite B, the bomb decal was added, and then in the latest update, they closed up the office overlooking the site, presumably to improve frame rates and to give workers a bit more privacy. Road markings have been added to the outside to make it look nicer. Also, a new tree made its way into the map. I assume it's one of them removed from cache recently. A broken deathmatch spawn in the gymnasium has been fixed. Apparently the C4 explosion wouldn't always inflict damage, but it will now. And there was also a way for players to boost out of the map, though I couldn't find it. As far as I could see, the map has been pretty well clipped up for a while. And that's it, have fun. Also, check out 2Clicks Philip's channel for some of my older videos, which were part of his recent upscaling project. He's been working on it non-stop for weeks. It drove him insane, At one point, he even started referring to himself in the third person.